Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Albert, for this warm welcome. I hope I can fulfill all these expectations. But I was asked to talk about the Dresden case. So I put the focus on the Dresden case, and I think it's also good for you because you will visit Dresden Elbe Valley tomorrow and you will see it yourself, so you can actually also find your own opinion to it. To be honest, I haven't seen the bridge when it was built up to now, so I'm also quite curious. But I will show you also a bit some framework about heritage impact assessment and also give you a bit, hopefully a bit of an idea of what the concept of heritage impact assessment is about. And you had already, we already discussed it this afternoon, but also in the morning, I think you also had several kinds of definition of heritage impact assessments. So I will talk a little bit about the question of what do heritage impact assessments have to do with the questions of visual integrity. I did a lot of studies about visual integrity, but I would like to emphasize that heritage impact assessments is much more than only the questions of visual integrity. But it was a major reason, this visual integrity question was a major reason that heritage impact assessment concept entered the World Heritage concept. Then I will come a bit on our methodology. I will try to explain you a bit how we are working, and then I will show you the Dresden case, and then I also brought some other cases with me, and I don't know how long I can talk, but I can also, you can also just interfere. So if you have questions, please don't hesitate to ask, and if I'm too fast or too slow, just let me know, please. So, some background information. I think you had already several definitions of impact assessments. I stick to this one for the moment, I must say, because IAIA, the International Association of Impact Assessments, is a non-governmental organization which is busy with impact assessments for quite a long time, much longer than we are. And this is the official IAIA definition, a process to identify, predict, evaluate, and communicate the probable effects of a current or proposed development policy or action on the cultural life. So it has to do with culture, but this is much more social in this case. Also on institutions, resources, and community. Then, that is very important, the red one, integrating the findings and conclusions into the planning and decision-making process with a view of mitigating adverse impacts and enhancing positive outcomes. So I put some colors in this definition. I will come back to this in my presentation, so hopefully it will be self-explaining. But the larger notion actually, or even I would say the better notion, is impact assessment. And as you see here, there are several kinds of assessments or impact assessments. Environmental impact assessments is one of them. Strategic impact assessment is also important for our European legislation because it's a strategic impact assessment, which is basically in hierarchy even higher than environmental impact assessments, because strategic impact assessments basically are trying to evaluate the impacts before project-based assessments are made. Then there are also social impact, impact assessments or cultural impact assessments. For instance, in Australia, there were impact assessments developed to evaluate impacts on the cultural life of indigenous people. Also in South Africa, there's a lot of experience in impact assessments. So this is quite interesting. So heritage impact assessments are just one part of this family that is important to know. And of course, they can cover various kinds of things. For instance, we have, of course, to deal with climate change. We have to deal with socioeconomic change. We have to deal with research. So for instance, archaeological research. So if you are excavating something, it always means that you destroy heritage. So even research can have negative impacts, and of course we also have to deal with our human influences on our natural environment. I said it already, IUCN also developed a guideline to assess impact on natural World Heritage sites, so this is also of course very important, but again, these are just some examples for assessments subjects. Then I come now to visual impact assessments. I will show you some of those cases a bit closer. This is Cologne. So for instance, impact assessments have to deal, of course, with building and development. So this was a case in Cologne. The very first impact assessment we were working on, a high-rise scheme just on the opposite side of the Rhine River. And this is the World Heritage Site, Cologne Cathedral. This is Dresden. I will come to that. This is London at the moment. London develops something approximately like 200 high-rise buildings at the moment, 200. This is the World Heritage Site London Tower, so of course this is changing the city silhouette dramatically. But also climate change or alternative energies. This is a German city, Wiesbaden, where we made an assessment which is basically addressing new wind turbines in the approximate, in the vicinity of a potential World Heritage Site. So again, back to the family, how basically heritage impact assessments are embedded. Strategic environmental impact assessment as strategic, really a very strategic scenario. Then environmental impact assessments, they are really addressing proposals, at least if they have a certain scale. So that is our European legislation, which is basically saying you have to do this, you have to do that. Heritage impact assessment is something extra. It is actually, at the moment, only applied at World Heritage Sites. And then, of course, you can have all kinds of different cultural subjects which can be addressed. For instance, visual integrity. I said it already, the ICOMOS guidelines were developed in 2011, and this came basically because there were quite negative experiences with environmental impact assessments. So the World Heritage Committee asked for impact assessments for years and years, but with unsatisfying results, because basically it was very difficult to address in these environmental impact assessments the question, which is a very special question, of outstanding universal value, integrity, and authenticity. And that is why ICOMOS basically developed this guideline in 2011 in order to make clear that in World Heritage Sites, actually, if you assess impact, it's always about OUV. So to conclude, basically, impact assessments do manifold things. You identify, you also predict, you evaluate, you communicate probable effects on a proposed development or a development which is even already there. So this is really a multiple activity which causes some difficulties, as you will see. Basically, impact assessments are used in various contexts. Cultural heritage or world heritage is just one of them. And basically, they have been introduced to address OUV. And it is absolutely not clear at the moment how heritage impact assessments can be embedded in European legislation. That is one of the major tasks, and I will come back to that in the, at the end of my lecture. Just some remarks on threats and methodologies. I mean, it's quite clear, this is a World Heritage Site, that these buildings are all new. They all came into existence in the last, let's say, 10 years. So, for instance, building development is a factor which is obviously leading to questions concerning visual integrity, but there are also other factors. This, for instance, is Istanbul. I had the opportunity to work in Istanbul several times already. But Istanbul is a city which was basically, this part of the city was included in the World Heritage List in 1985, when the city had 5.5 million inhabitants. At the moment, Istanbul has some 13 to 14 million inhabitants, and in 10 years it could already have 20 million inhabitants. So the city is really growing very, very fast. And of course, this might affect Istanbul's World Heritage or cultural heritage in general. One of the questions I had to work on was the idea to build a bridge. This is basically the World Heritage Site. This is an important part of it, it's an important mosque. And we were asked whether this bridge basically could be built here. It's a metro bridge, which is terribly necessary in Istanbul because Istanbul needs public transport facilities. But on the other side, of course, this bridge scheme will have an effect also on the silhouette of the city. So you see, these questions are quite difficult to answer very often. For instance, this metro line is very important for the sustainable development of the city, but on the other side, it has also, that was at least our conclusion, a negative impact on the city silhouette. So you have to ask yourself constantly as a consultant, what is more important? Is it the silhouette, or is it basically the sustainable development of public transport and the city as a whole? So heritage impact assessment is not always very easy to answer these kind of questions. This is Cologne again, buildings and development. I said that already. This is again Wiesbaden, so you know that already, so I can be a bit quicker. This is Vienna. Vienna is a city, is the capital of Austria with 2.2 million inhabitants at the moment. It's also a city which is growing quite fast at the moment. And Vienna also has experience with skyscrapers or high-rise schemes in the World Heritage Site. So this is, for instance, a site which is at the moment developed and in discussion. But you see also, this is the World Heritage Area of Vienna, the red line. This is the buffer zone. And you see also that most of these high-rise schemes are developed outside of the buffer zone. So basically what you can see is that, of course, these high-rise schemes will affect the World Heritage Area and also the city's silhouette, but they are basically located outside of the buffer zone of the city. So you see that the system and also the instruments we have to protect the World Heritage, for instance like buffer zones, that these instruments just don't work. And of course, it's also in juridical terms quite difficult to answer a question whether a high-rise scheme might be built here, for instance, although it is located outside of the buffer zone. But still, of course, it's affecting the World Heritage. So this is a difficult question. These are all difficult questions to answer. And this is a diagram or a table out of the SOC reports. It's quite interesting to study these SOC reports, and you see that a quite large part of questions is caused by buildings and development. Cases like Cologne, for instance. Transportation infrastructure, like you saw in Istanbul, is also a very important item. A lot of sites are affected by transportation infrastructure. But also new service infrastructure, like in the city of Wiesbaden, is also quite an important item. So this is why the question of visual impact and integrity is quite important in the context of World Heritage, because loads of World Heritage sites are struggling at the moment with these kinds of questions. Next to others, of course, like climate change and sudden earthquakes, and these kind of things. A few words to the methodology. So what you see here is basically all kinds of steps you should run through when you are working on an impact assessment. And again, I put next to it this YaYa definition, so you see a bit the colors, what kind of activity is what. So for instance, identifying has very much to do with screening, predicting, evaluating, and communicating has very much to do with scoping. So scoping means that you basically have to identify the stakeholders, who is there, who is doing what. So you have to understand everything. You also have to define your terms of references if this is not done yet. Then you come up with the actual analysis. So basically try to understand what is going to happen, and basically also to assess what is basically the impact, at least in the World Heritage context, on OUV, authenticity and integrity. But that is by far not all. If you have done all this, the work just starts, because then you have to communicate basically the results to the public, also to decision makers. You have to come up with mitigation proposals, and then you have to monitor whether your heritage basically and the effectiveness to guarantee also the effectiveness of the heritage impact assessment. So these are really a lot of steps to run through, and as I will show in the case of Dresden, in a lot of heritage impact assessment, there's very little chance to do this really decently, all these steps, because we are working very often under an enormous time pressure. So this is to you, you can just read it through, identifying projects and also sites which require HIAS, predicting consequences has to do with scoping, understanding and assessing, communicating the results, embed everything in the measures, in planning and decision, suggesting measures for negative, but also stimulating positive impact, that's also important, and to survey the effectiveness, once again. So factors leading to problems with visual integrity, as I've shown, are urban growth, building development, transportation infrastructure, service infrastructure. But what is important to know in terms of visual integrity, that most of our instruments just don't work. The World Heritage Preservation System is, in my opinion, a quite weak system. Also in political terms, it's often quite weak and vague. And basically the methodology of the heritage impact assessment you apply have basically to cover all these kind of things, but also these various steps I've just shown. So that is quite complex task. And a lot of heritage impact assessment tasks are that complex that it's difficult to manage it alone, because there are just too many questions. So you have to also to form a team to answer all these questions. And I will show you now a case, the case of Dresden, and I hope you will understand better what this all means if you are just working on these kind of questions. You will get to know this, I must say, former World Heritage Site. Dresden Elbe Valley is not a World Heritage Site anymore, as you know. It was withdrawn from the World Heritage List in 2009. But this shows how the World Heritage Site was conceived in 2004. It's a stretch of a river valley, of the river Elbe, which is roughly 20 kilometers long. It was nominated as a cultural landscape. A cultural landscape with a very complex relationship between man and nature. So basically the Dresden Elbe Valley was for hundreds and hundreds of years more or less designed with a certain kind of landscape idea. And that is also one important aspect to why the Dresden Elbe Valley was nominated also successfully as World Heritage. And you see some of these man-made designs here. These are the so-called Elbe castles, which are just put on this hilly area. It's over here. And then you have these kind of views into the city center, which is actually here. So it's a quite sophisticated stretch of landscape, very interesting. But the question we had to work on was whether at this point here, quite close to the city center, you will see tomorrow, a bridge could be built, a quite complex bridge, a traffic thoroughfare, with a four-lane bridge, also a light rail on it, which is leading into a tunnel, which is also 1 kilometer long. So this is basically this arteria here, and this part leads to the city center. So it's not really a city bridge, in my opinion. It's quite more like a motorway-like bridge, but you will see it tomorrow. And this plan to build the bridge came known to the World Heritage Center in 2005, so roughly 1 year after the nomination of the World Heritage Site. So, and this says already that the World Heritage Center and also the World Heritage Committee, they were not conscious about the fact that this bridge was planned when the site was nominated for the World Heritage List. So this was a major problem in this case. I will come back to this. And then 6 weeks before the tendering procedure, we were asked to come up with an impact assessment. So we had 6 weeks time to work on this evaluation. So you see, this is very, very short to do all these steps I've just shown you in 6 weeks' time. And this was because the tendering procedure was coming up. So basically, this was a deadline for us. What we did, or what we always do, is this is a bit our methodology. We try to get to know all the stakeholders. We try to understand the investigation area. We also always make a risk analysis. And I show you also why we do that. Because not every heritage impact assessment leads to an improvement of the situation, as you will see in short. So we basically do an overall process design. We then do what we call a formal analysis. So we try to understand what is the OUV. But I don't know whether you have looked into OUV sheets, statements of OUV. Mostly they are quite vague, very difficult to understand, very abstract, and also very difficult to understand what this means for this assessment, for instance. So OUV is a crucial concept in World Heritage, but it's a very weak concept when you try to get it concrete, which kind of values are actually there. And then, again, you have also to deal with the problem that outstanding universal value is a universal value, but there are also other kinds of values which might differ considerably from the outstanding universal value. So this is a very complex question, how to deal with these kind of values. So we try what we call to functionalize the OUV in order to get it more concrete for our studies. And then we start also to dive into the planning history, the conflict history very often. because as you will also see in short that most of the conflicts we are dealing with have a very, very long history in city planning. And in Dresden it was also the case. This bridge basically was planned, or the ideas to build a bridge, they are more than 100 years old. Then we did a thing we call content analysis. So we try to understand the planning history, we try to understand art history. I will show you in short why. And we also try also to understand symbolic and immaterial values. So that is basically more or less an analysis which is dealing with all kinds of values which are already there. We try just to understand it. And then that we call the four-step impact analysis, we try to understand what is the visual impact. So we just show how the scheme basically would impact or influence the site. And then we would come up with mitigation measures. So this is just in a nutshell what Dresden is about, but Dresden, you could call it in short a Baroque city. Dresden, there was a very important man who was called August der Starke, August the Strong, and he had the idea, basically he developed the idea to develop Dresden as a residential city in a Baroque shape, and he also developed the idea to embrace and integrate the Dresden Elbe Valley into this shape. So it's a quite interesting shape. And the center of this idea is the Church of Our Lady. So it's basically also a visual center in the city. And as you can see, this is a very very important, well-known painter, Canaletto. He painted this view on Dresden. That was basically the idea how Dresden would represent itself to everybody, to be seen as a residential and important city. 200 years further in the 19th century, this idea was brought further. It was more influenced by civic people, important citizens of Dresden, who had the idea to build villas on these hills. But basically it was very much prolonging this idea of August der Starke. So again, you see here these Elbe castles, you see here all these kind of villas. You also see these kind of touristical elements. Where you just would go on this hilly area and see or would enjoy the view towards the city center and the Church of Our Lady. So this is basically the visual idea in a nutshell about the Dresden Elbe Valley. And you see also, if you look into the art presentations, and that these ideas are constantly kind of generated or regenerated also by artists. That is why it's very interesting to look into these kind of art presentations, because they tell a lot about how these kind of ideas are to be understood. So for instance, this is also a painting from the early 19th century. This is a photograph from the early 20th century. You'll be here at exactly this spot tomorrow, and this is the same spot 100 years ago, roughly. So you see that these kind of views or important views are constantly repeated. And basically so the city population, also visitors, they know cities by these views. So that is very important for questions of visual integrity to understand how these kind of view systems actually work. What you see here is that, I told you already, that this idea to build a bridge in Dresden, so this is for instance also an idea to build a bridge over the river Elbe, which is dating from 1908, I think. So there was constantly the idea, on the one hand, we have to build a bridge here, but on the other hand, there was also the idea that we have to protect somehow and to preserve this kind of idea, this Baroque idea of the Elbe Valley, also these kind of Elbe meadows, which are very valuable because the Elbe is the only river in Germany which is still not canalized. So there were basically conflicting views on the Dresden Elbe Valley. Even in the 1930s, you can already see it, so this is a shape which is basically pointing out these Elbe meadows, but on the other hand, there was also the idea to build this bridge. And that is basically also the core of the conflict of the Waldschlösschen Bridge. And what you can see here is another important thing which happened in Dresden. You might know that Dresden was completely bombed out in 1944, in the very end of the Second World War. This is how the Church of Our Lady looked in 1974, but it looked like it also until the 1990s, but then the church was rebuilt. So, and it was ready in 2005. So exactly when the question of the Waldschlösschen Bridge came up, this reconstruction of the Church of Our Lady was ready. So these were kind of parallel things. which also affected this conflict quite a lot. So what you see here is just a part of our analysis. You see here all kinds of relevant views to the Church of Our Lady from the Dresden Elbe Valley World Heritage Site. And here you see these kind of views inside the valley, or the bottom of the valley. So this is basically a very important result for us if we investigate questions of visual integrity, because we try to understand where are the important vistas, how are these vistas working, what's the quality of it, and how might maybe might the bridge in this case affect these kind of views. So that is basically the core of a question of visual integrity. So what you see here, this is also part of our research. All kinds of sequences. So you might walk here tomorrow, you will see that. So you basically, this is the core of, again, of this visual system, the Church of Our Lady, but then there are several kinds of vistas and side systems inside the valley itself. And this is very important for us to understand all these kind of things. Then what we always do is we remodel the whole site we have to investigate in 3D. So this is a part of it, so we rebuild the site and then we try to show what basically how the site would be affected. But we show it, and that is very important, we not just show it, we show it on basis of this analysis in order to make sure that we can also assess it in the right manner, also in terms of OUV, but also in terms of the site connections I just have shown. So for instance, this important point, you will be there tomorrow, would be affected like this. Of course you will see the church, but also you can see that the bridge, of course, will change this site quite a lot. And this is another visualization just to show you how this works. If you're on the bottom of the valley at a certain kind of points, the site view will be blocked to the church. So we had the impression that this bridge would affect the World Heritage Site quite dramatically, also because the outstanding universal value clearly pointed out that the site connection is a very important part of the outstanding universal value of the site. So we came to the result that the bridge basically would obscure a number of relevant views in the Dresden skyline. We also had the idea that the bridge would cut this cohesive landscape in two halves. And we also made an analysis about the Elbe bridges. I didn't show you that for time reasons, but in scale, the Walschessen bridge is really something different than the other city bridges in Dresden. It's not really a city bridge, it's more or less a traffic thoroughfare. So we recommended to rethink, to modify at least this planning scheme, and to communicate it and do this in cooperation with UNESCO World Heritage Committee and the advisory bodies. So that was the result basically of our impact assessment. But as you see, what happened, basically this was not done. What happened is that the bridge was built. Dresden's population was torn in two halves. Roughly 50% of the population were in favor of the bridge, maybe even more, and the other half of the city was against it. So the heritage impact assessment didn't help basically to overcome this kind of tension. Absolutely not. I would say, in the contrary, it even increased the tensions in the city. There was a large discussion in Dresden about the World Heritage, also about building a tunnel, these kind of things. But in the end, basically, the site was withdrawn from the World Heritage list. So why did that happen? And why did also the heritage impact assessment was not successful? And it's very important also to look, if you're dealing with heritage impact assessments, in these kind of processes very, very thoroughly. These are just some milestones of this conflict before the site was nominated as a World Heritage Site. So what you see here, the whole story started not in 2004, it started in 1988, because there was an idea in the former GDR, when Dresden belonged to the former GDR, to nominate Dresden City Center for the World Heritage List. But this nomination proposal failed, because ICOMOS said that this city center is not authentic. I've shown you the pictures of the city center of Dresden. It is absolutely not authentic anymore because it was bombed down. But basically, this was the reason why this nomination proposal failed. Then in 1979 already, so roughly 8 years before the list was inscribed for the World Heritage List, there was an international design competition for the Walschlösschen Bridge. So this design was known at least from 1997. Then basically the planning procedure was also started in 2002. And then 2003, there was an ECOMOS evaluation of the nomination proposal. And a quite crucial mistake happened because ECOMOS located a bridge 5 kilometers down from the Dresden city center. So there was just a mistake made, and I don't know why this was done. But there was just a simple mistake in the evaluation process. And there was a second mistake also. The second mistake was that the city of Dresden and also the officials in the Federal Republic of Saxony didn't communicate well with the World Heritage Center, the advisory body, because they didn't basically tell anybody that the bridge plans were actually there. And this is how the site was inscribed in the World Heritage List. So you see that the all the major problems are already there before the site was nominated. Several communication failures prior to inscription. Then there was a second phase of the conflict, which was taking place between 2005 and 2006. So basically, they took a referendum place, and Dresden's population voted in favor of the bridge at this referendum. But again, this was not communicated well to the World Heritage Center. Also, there was an information procedure taking place, but an unofficial one. Just some citizens from Dresden, they went to the World Heritage Center and said, listen, we are really concerned because these bridge plans are suddenly there. Can you do something about it? So this is how UNESCO was interfered in this project, not by the city of Dresden, not by the officials of Saxony. It was done by the citizens of Dresden. And that is basically, very often we have to do these kind of questions, how communications works or not works. Then the World Heritage Center requested the local authorities to inform them. This was in September 2005, and finally in the end of November, so nearly in the end of the year 2005, some information came up, but not about the juridical situation of the bridge. So as you might remember, basically the tendering procedure was already started. Also the bridge, also the planning procedure was also made official. So basically in official terms, the bridge was already there. All the planning instruments were already settled. Then everybody asked themselves what to do about it. So the director of the World Heritage Center asked to come up with a visual impact assessment in order to get clarity what to do. And that is how we were involved. This was in the end of 2006. So 6 weeks before tendering, we were involved. But it was already very late because the tendering procedure means basically that the city already committed itself to the bridge because there was an incredible high fine if the bridge wouldn't have been built. So there was already a lot of pressure, and this was no way actually to come up with mitigation measures in this case, simply because there was no time for it, but also there was no latitude for it. So you see that HIA was commissioned much too late, and basically the results of the HIA couldn't be communicated decently, and also measures for mitigation could not be developed during the study. So we came to a negative result, but we couldn't develop a mitigation measure, and we couldn't also communicate with all the stakeholders what to do with it. So basically, when we came up with our study, more or less the decision makers in Dresden, but also the decision maker of UNESCO, were left alone with a negative result, and nobody knew what to do with it. And this is why the third phase of this conflict turned out like this. You see, from 2006 to 2009, in 2009 the bridge was delisted. So in 2006, basically, there was a reactive monitoring mission. Due to our study, the site was put on the World Heritage List in danger. This was also taking place in 2006. Afterwards, in 2007 and 2008, there were several attempts to come up with mediation measures, but none of them worked. So basically, there was really a rising tension between local and regional decision makers of the federal state of Saxony and the city of Dresden and UNESCO. And finally, the site was delisted. But as you might understand, the basic problem basically was already clear prior to the nomination. So the basic mistakes were already made prior to the nomination. And that is an experience we have incredibly often, that mistakes are made during nomination procedures or that problems are well known but not well communicated. And then sites are nominated, and afterwards we get it on our table and have to solve it, but we can't. So this is a very common problem in terms of visual integrity. So to summarize this, basically the HIA is commissioned too late. This happens unfortunately quite often. There's no latitude to come up with mitigation strategies, so there was no chance basically to come up with a proper mitigation process. The decision makers were left alone with negative results and with no way out, so basically it means that even the tension was increasing due to this fact. Also the confrontation in Dresden city population increased, and also there were really extreme tensions between local and international stakeholders. That also happens very, very often. If you have a conflict in the World Heritage Site, everybody loves the concept of World Heritage if there are no problems, and everybody is proud of that, but if the problems are popping up, it becomes more difficult and the tensions are rising. That happens also quite often. So basic measures of Dresden is that we can learn from this conflict to do it better. And I will show you some projects where we at least try to do it better. But also another basic message is heritage impact assessment cannot solve political questions, because we were settled up with a political question. But a heritage impact assessment is a strategic instrument to come up with strategic solutions. But it's very, very difficult to solve with a heritage impact assessment political questions which cannot be solved by the stakeholders themselves. So that is basically a huge difference. Conclusion, what can heritage impact assessments do? Back to the case of Cologne. This is Cologne Cathedral, which was listed, I don't know exactly, I think in 1996 or 95. Just the cathedral, not a cultural landscape or an historic urban landscape. But the question in Cologne was that this is the River Rhine, this is the cathedral, that at this spot, this scheme was about to be developed. This is roughly 1 kilometer. So the question was, can this be developed, and how would this development, basically this cluster of five high-rise buildings, how would this affect the skyline of Cologne? Because as Cologne city skyline is very well known for the very well known shape of the cathedral. Again, we made the same thing we just shown in Dresden. So we dived into an analysis and we came up again with the same kind of diagrams. So these are important site connections. In this case, they are, in Cologne's case, they are important viewpoints, but they are also important roads which are leading to the city center, which are also providing very interesting views to the cathedral. And it's very, very important for commuters to see the cathedral, and as soon as you see the cathedral, you are in Cologne. So basically, the Cologne cathedral has much more values than only the substantial value of the cathedral itself. It's also symbolic value for the whole city. It's more or less an icon for the whole city. So as you might see or understand in this visualization, is that this new kind of, let's call it crown of the city, next to this old crown would basically confuse the system. That was at least our impression or our result from our study. So we came up with the idea to think about this opposite side of the Rhine in a different manner than the city of Cologne used to do it. Cologne has a very strange kind of planning history, because the left-hand side of the Rhine is called the right side, so the right, and so this is the good side, let's say, and this is the wrong side. So any kind of development which was problematic, for instance, industrial developments, were always put on the right-hand side of the Rhine, and nobody really cared about this area of the city. But of course, in terms of view, and in terms of view on the city silhouette, on the historic city silhouette, this area is very, very important. So we came up with the idea to extend the buffer zone. But what much more important even was that we said, okay, you have to think about an alternative for this planning scheme. So we said, okay, it would be interesting to have a planning workshop together with citizens of the city, but also with architectural and planning offices in order to develop an alternative planning scheme. And that basically took place. This is also, in a nutshell, it was a very long and also complicated story. But to make it short, this development of the five high-rise buildings was changed in a more flatter but more dense planning scheme, which is at the most 60 meters high. And this is basically how it looks or will look in several years, hopefully. So basically in Cologne, it was due to this communication process, a successful heritage impact assessment in the end, because basically it was possible in this case to get the Cologne Cathedral from the World Heritage List in danger, and also to develop a more sustainable scheme. What is also quite interesting about the scheme is that it is also more sustainable in terms of a building development, because it's much easier to use this kind of planning of building structure, because these kind of high-rise schemes have always the problems that they are very much dependent on tenants, what tenants do. And they are difficult to rent out, but this is much more flexible, but it was also more in economical terms, because the structure is more dense, it was also more in economical terms a much better scheme. So in this case, the question about cultural heritage basically led also to a much more sustainable planning scheme, and that is quite interesting, or an interesting effect in my opinion. Another case of successful thinking about heritage impact assessments and city silhouette is Lübeck. Lübeck is in the north of Germany, in the northeast, one could say. It's this site basically is the World Heritage Site. It's an island, a medieval city core, which is very, very well known for its characteristic city silhouette. So these kind of church towers, they always coined the city silhouette of Lübeck for hundreds and hundreds of years. But in Lübeck there was a question whether at this area wind turbines could be built. And as you might see in this plan, is that the city of Lübeck is more or less a flat area, which is surrounded by hills. So you have very, very long and wide vistas, and you can see basically the city silhouette from far. And in this area were several sites planned, where wind turbines were planned, which were roughly 200 meters high. So again, a colleague of us came up with this study. This was not done by us, it was done by the city of Lübeck themselves. So they basically also analyzed the relevant sidelines, and they included this into the management plan of the city. And they also succeeded in to convince also the adjacent cities to respect the sidelines to Lübeck city center. And again, you can see that this is the buffer zone. So the buffer zone is this large. And this is basically the area which is more or less relevant for the study. So again, you can see that the system of buffer zones is not working. It's more questions about regional planning, more or less. But in this case, it was quite successful. So I hope that the Lübeck city silhouette will be safe for the future. But I don't know exactly. But it was a quite interesting study. Then you basically came up with the question, or one of you came up with the question, how planning procedures or processes basically could be influenced by heritage impact assessments. That is why I included very quickly these charts. It was an investigation which is still not finished in the Upper Middle Rhine Valley. The Upper Middle Rhine Valley is like Dresden Elbe Valley. It's very similar. It's also a cultural landscape. It's a site which is 50 kilometers long, also very strongly urbanized, but then also well known for its steep vineyards in the valley. So this is basically pretty much the same than the Dresden Elbe Valley, also nominated as a cultural landscape. But there are also quite some problems in the Rhine Valley. One of them is that there's very much train traffic in the valley. There's really a lot of noise pollution. And the noise pollution has quite negative effects on the sites, because a lot of even historical sites which are valuable are left empty, because people just can't stand the noise there. So there's a question of shrinkage there. We were asked whether at this part of the valley an alternative routing for the train tracks could be planned in the Upper Middle Rhine Valley. So that was the idea, because this tunnel of the train track, these are all monuments, but these tunnels are very, very old. So they have to be either renewed, but or a completely new train track has to be built there. And the German railway networks, they developed 5 alternative railway tracks. And our role in this process was to evaluate these, the effect on the impact of these railway tracks, of these newly planned railway tracks, on the cultural heritage and the world heritage of the valley. So these are the tunnel ports. You can see here, these are all monuments, but these are the tunnels in question. This one is here. And this is basically just at least an idea about the cultural heritage there. For instance, this city here has a well-known fortress system, and this is an important part of it. So what we did there was basically the same than in the other studies. We just tried to make transparent and clear what is going to happen. So this is just a new entrance, and a new entrance here in our computer model. And then we tried to show our commissioner, which is German Rail Networks, but also the city's development, the city's inhabitants, which were also included into the process, by a process of participation, what is going to happen in the valley. So this again is this part of the city's fortress, and in this case we have just shown that this fortress or part of the fortress would just not be there if this plan would come through. And it's very interesting if you talk to this about with traffic planners, because they just, oh, we didn't understand, we didn't know that this is valuable. But in this case it was basically prior to the planning process, or it was during the planning process, and basically we could influence which kind, also which kind of influence would be the least negative or the most positive for the valley and for the cultural heritage of the valley. And then we tried to modify these tunnel entrances, also in terms of material and shape, in order to get an overall impression which tracks basically could be chosen with the least impact and with the most positive results. So this is basically a more or less ideal way how heritage impact assessment should be used, in my opinion. Because in this case it was possible, at least up to now, to steer this kind of planning process in a quite successful manner. So what can heritage impact assessments do? They can help to monitor agents of change. They can also help to scope and scoping processes. They can help to understand the values of sites better than because this is very, very important in complex sites at Dresden Elbe Valley or historical urban landscapes, because there are several things which are important next to the matter. In my opinion, heritage impact assessment, that is the most important thing, is that it's a communication tool. You should use it to communicate better, but you see also in the case of Dresden it didn't work due to several reasons. Then what is also important, what I've just shown, is to integrate the results of the heritage impact assessment in the planning process, or at least in the decision process, because if you don't feed it back the results, it won't help. So this is basically how it should work. And also mitigation, of course, or stimulating positive impact is also very important. And then in the end, you also have to monitor the effectiveness of your study. That can be done in the ideal case, but in a lot of cases it's not working like that. I also have to say clearly in this round. But this would be the idea, use it as a communication tool. Also in questions like in Dresden, where a lot of tension is between local stakeholders, national ones, and international ones. But then, as you might understand also from this lecture, is that there are lots of questions also which are combined with heritage impact assessments. For instance, the question of methodology. So a lot of heritage impact assessments are made, and as I've shown in the beginning of this lecture, there's also guidance for heritage impact assessments. But the quality and also the methodology approach are really very much differing up to now. Though there's not that much clarity about the methodology, how the ideal way of heritage impact assessment basically should look like. And all the heritage impact assessments I've shown just more or less developed in an empirical manner. We just did it and learned by doing, more or less. Then there's the question of effectiveness. It's not clear yet how effective heritage impact assessments are. Basically, if I submit a heritage impact assessment, mostly I don't get to know what is basically happening to it. So it's absolutely unclear also for me as a researcher what basically how effective these studies actually are. Then there are also national differences. Some states parties are applying heritage impact assessments, others don't, for several reasons. Then there's also the questions that there are varying purposes for cultural heritage management. Basically, I've shown you heritage impact assessments which were commissioned due to political reasons. Others are commissioned due to planning and development reasons. So that affects, of course, also the methodologies of the studies and also the outcomes of the studies. Then there's the question I've mentioned in the very beginning of this lecture, legislation. How can heritage impact assessments be embedded into legislation frameworks, environmental impact assessments, and also strategic impact assessments? Then it's completely unclear yet how people can or should participate in these kind of impact assessments evaluation processes. There's also the question of guidance. The ICOMOS guidance is there, but it also has some weak points, in my opinion. And then there's a question of training. Who actually can basically do these kind of complex studies? Because you need to deal with very different things also. So you need also training. So there are several things which should be solved in the future. So in my opinion, heritage impact assessment are not clear, or not clear instrument at all. And that was the reason why we from RWTH Aachen University tried to investigate these kind of questions, and we did a research project. We just started it this fall of the year, the first phase with several workshops, in order to get an idea about all these questions. So we invited experts, also representatives of state parties, of advisory bodies to help us and to come together and network and to exchange thoughts. And that was a quite successful project up to now, very interesting. So we did three workshops, and the last workshop is just 1 week, took place 1 week before. And the outcomes of the workshop in a nutshell is that we had the impression it's very important to build up these kind of networks, to enclose practitioners, to enclose also researchers, to get to know and get into contact with representatives of state parties and advisory bodies, and also with a representative of the World Heritage Center, in order to exchange thoughts, because everybody has a different view on heritage impact assessment, and everybody is in this decision line, but not really communicating well. So that is very, very important. We also had the idea it's very important to expand databases of heritage impact assessment. So that is basically a future project we will hopefully start soon, that we will try to collect data systematically in order to get ideas, for instance, about effectiveness of these studies. Then we want to generate a virtual heritage impact assessment platform, which means basically that everybody should be able to find information about heritage impact assessments, best practices, but also guidances, and also other kinds of ideas on this platform. We would also like to elaborate and clarify the assessment strategies and feed this back into the ICOMOS guidance. And ICOMOS was happy with this, basically. Also, we would like to clarify this legislative situations of heritage impact assessment. And also, there is a lot of future research to be put in training strategies. So there's a lot of work on heritage impact assessments to be done, also for researchers. So if you're interested in this item, I think for the next 20 years, there's a lot of room for research. And that is basically the end of my lecture. So thank you very much.